Hello, everybody, and welcome to Sabbath School Study Group, where this week we're looking at the idea of covetousness and God's plan to overcome it. Covetousness is really broken up in that phrase. What is it? I see, I want, I take. So that's why today we want to talk about greed, having things your way. Where does that play into this spirit? How does it manifest itself in our greed? And again, how can we be set free? And so one of the things that we want to do is remember our verse of warning and inspiration for this week, Matthew 13, verse 22, which says, "He also that receives seed among the thorns is he that heareth the word, and the care of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he becometh unfruitful." Lord, if this is not your desire, that any of us would have to walk this way, instead, may we walk in the fruitful path because of what we're going to study now. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, thank the Lord that we don't have to walk that way or talk that way. In fact, we can live a fruitful life, true gospel prosperity, as found in the scriptures. And the first thing we got to understand is, first of all, when we're dealing with greed, greed is not good, contrary to what the world may say. See, the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 56, verse 11, "Yea, they are greedy dogs, which can never have enough. And they are shepherds that cannot understand. They all look to their own way, every one for his gain from his quarter." This is a beautiful verse that really breaks down greed and what it is. It's wanting for yourself, wanting it your own way, but never having enough. And that is an important part, because in Ecclesiastes 5, verse 10, it says it this way: "He that loveth silver shall not be satisfied with silver, nor he that loveth abundance with increase. This is also vanity." Greed is essentially a spirit of unsatisfaction, and it is a spirit that cannot be satisfied according to scripture, because in Ecclesiastes chapter 6, it says, "All the labor of man is for his mouth." And yet, even with the greedy drive, the appetite is not filled. The appetite is not filled. So greed is an insatiable appetite. Greed is an endless desire. And that's why when we look at the world and its ideal of what greed is, it cannot be good, because it can't even be realized. It cannot be gratified. So when you have this film, this old film, I believe it was 1987, Wall Street, and the most famous line of the film is when Michael Douglas and his character Gordon Gekko is making this speech to shareholders as he's raiding the company and he's getting his. But to get them to make the decisions that they need to make so that he can make his profit, he tells the crowd and he told the world, greed is good. It underscored the ideals of the 80s and the get rich quick and the stock market boom. But it really underscores a human condition that's built off greed, that says it's good. It drives capitalism, or it motivates production, and it fuels industry. And while on a certain level it does, but the Bible makes it plain that it's bad fuel. It's insatiable. And it only leaves a very few standing at the very top, where masses are huddled and struggling below. This greed and its insatiable appetite is also fatal. Greed kills, based on what the Bible says. Because Matthew 26, 14 says, "Then one of the 12, called Judas Iscariot, went unto the chief priests. And he said, wow, greed is good. In fact, I'll use my greed to help out this whole plan of Jesus becoming the Messiah." So he gets his mind twisted with greed and says to them, to the chief priest, "What will you give me? And I will give him to you. I'll sell you Jesus." And they covenant with him for 30 pieces of silver. And from that time, he sought opportunity to betray him. Greed is what killed Judas's faith. And with that kind of death in him, it drove him even to kill Jesus. Greed kills. In fact, when you look at it in Joshua 7, in the story of Achan that we reviewed in yesterday's study. And if you haven't watched that one, go back and read it, because we talked about the definition of covetousness. Today we focus on the definitions of greed. Because Joshua and all Israel with him took Achan, the son of Zerah, and the silver that he stole, and the garment that he coveted, and the wedge of gold that he greeded over. And they took his sons and his daughters and his oxen and his asses and his sheep and his tent, where he hid everything, and all that he had. And they brought them unto the valley of Achor. And Joshua said, Why hast thou troubled us? The Lord shall trouble thee this day. And all Israel stoned him with stones and burned them with fire after they had stoned them with stones. Greed kills. And they raised over him so great a heap of stones unto this day. So the Lord turned from the fierceness of his anger. Wherefore the name of that place was called the Valley of Achor unto this day. Please be clear. God loved Achan. God loved his family. It was the greed that the Lord hates. And it was the greed in them that he hated. And it was the greed that killed them. Proverbs 1 says, For their feet run to evil and make haste to shed blood, talking about the greedy heart. Surely in vain the net is spread in the sight of any bird, and they lay wait for their own blood, and they look privately for their own lives. So are the ways of everyone that is greedy of gain, which taketh away the life of the owners thereof. Do you see it? Greed kills faith. Greed kills compassion. Greed kills love. And you become a killer to the point where you take away the life of the owners thereof if it will give you gain. And it takes your life because of your greed. Your greed will even consume you. Why? Because it's an appetite that cannot be filled. Machiavelli even testified to it, where he said, of mankind, we may say in general, they are fickle, hypocritical, and greedy of gain. Even in Scripture and out of Scripture, a testament to the truth of our condition, we are greedy. That's why we need grace. Having it your way may make good burgers, but not good living. We've taken greed and we've gussied it up, and we've made it attractive. We've even said it's a good thing, something to be desired, to be satisfied. But Proverbs chapter 21 says, the way of man, our way, having it our way, it's forward and strange. But as for the pure, his work is right. So the idea of having it your way, that's strange to God. That's anti-heaven. It disrupts the atmosphere of what love is supposed to be about. So when Burger King busted out with this promotion in the early 70s and they marketed it in this way, they said, well, you know, you can have burgers your way. Unlike the big boys or the other company, which at that time, McDonald's, and even today, they have a stock set way, and you got it no matter where you were. You could be in New York, Topeka, Kansas, or San Jose, California. You're going to get the same burger. But Burger King said, well, we're going to flip it, and you'll make your Whopper, and you can make it the way you want it. But that's not good living, because the way that we want stuff, the way of a fool, is right in his own eyes. Tastes good to me. But that's foolish. Instead, he that hearkeneth unto counsel, in other words, which way should I go, Lord? That's a wise man. Proverbs 12:15 says. And when you look here in Proverbs 14, it says, there is a way which seemeth right unto a man. But the end of his way, that way, are the ways of death. See, we can only see but so high. Like a child who can only see but so far. They don't know to look both ways across the street, or they don't know that candy, it might look like candy, but it's actually plastic. That way seems right to that child, to run out in the street or to eat that plastic toy, but that way leads to death, because they just don't know. In the same way, we don't know the end of our way. We don't know where it ultimately leads, because in the eyes of God and in the context of humanity, we're all just children. We're all sheep in need of a shepherd. And to think that we can live life on our terms while we were not the ones who started or gave this life, it's like the person who buys the item from the store and refuses to take it back, refuses to give it to the manufacturer, but instead tinkers with it, and in tinkering with it, destroys it. When God's ideal is that rather than tinkering and trying to do it our way, let's take it back. Let's take the defective stuff back to the manufacturer. And the manufacturer warns us. He tells us, the Creator says, he also that receives seed among the thorns is he that hears the word. But the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches, the gas of greed chokes the word, and we become unfruitful. But we can be wise. We can be just as simply as we make a bad decision, we can easily make a good one. And that is, not my way, Lord, but your way, your will be done. Till next time, let's do it his way, because he loves us.